So good to be in God's house. I love to watch people just greeting one another and passing the peace among each other. I'm excited you all are in for a treat today. I drove up here for this moment today. Many of you know Quentin, and he is not just an intern. This brother has done so much already this summer. He's studying at Trinity, and 2 years ago, we were just talking. You guys may not know that 2 years ago, when he first visited the States, he didn't speak any English, and he's preaching the word 2 years later on Sunday morning. It's amazing. Thank you. But there's another reason why I brought him up, is that it was 2 years ago this week that I visited Harvest incognito, if you can believe that. And his family member, who many of you know, Pastor Christian Barbosa, was preaching in Rolling Meadows, and it was the first time that I ever attended Harvest and didn't know his story, and he didn't know mine. And so I'm just glad to be here with you, brother. I want you to lean in. God's word is coming this morning, and it's so good to have you with us. Let's give it up again for Quentin.
Okay. You hear me? Okay, all glory to Jesus. I hope you clap for him because I'm not deserving any of that. Harvest family, just before I start, I want to thank you. You cannot imagine how honored I am to be here. And that's because of your love for me that I'm here today. And I just wanted to thank you before we start. Let's pray together. King of heaven, we want now to come in your presence. We ask you to open our hearts to your word. Father, we want to only listen to your voice right now. Make our hands, our hearts, our mind ready to receive what you have prepared already for us. Amen. Amen. Okay, if you were here last week, Pastor Jeff introduced our new series called Unsung. He led us through Hebrews 11, where the Bible tells us about all those great heroes of faith. You know, we call that the hall of faith. And you know there are those great guys like Moses, like Abraham, like David. But there are also a lot of guys we do not talk about. And this summer, we want to put them under the spotlight. They are the unsung heroes of the Bible. And this sermon, as you can see in your outline, is called Relentless Faith. The faith which persevere all the time. So let me tell you about a man who had a relentless faith. He's a personal hero of mine. His name is Francis of Assisi. He was an Italian Christian in the 13th century. And this guy experienced one of the most radical conversions I ever heard of. He was a really rich guy. And when he discovered who Christ is, when he had his encounter with the living God, he laid literally everything aside to give it to the poor, to help the needy. But the most amazing thing about him is that he loved the lepers. And as you may know, leprosy is a terrible disease, very contagious. But Francis did not care. He went with them, he touched them, he kissed them. Because he knew that those people were image bearers of God, and therefore they were valuable. And he showed them so much love. And today, we're going to talk about another great act of love, which is also the greatest act of trespassing in the whole Bible. So please bear with me and open your Bible to Mark chapter 2. And we're going to read from verse 1. And when he returned to Capernaum after some day, it was reported that he was at home. And many were gathered together, though there was no more room, not even at the door. And he was preaching the word to them. And they came, bringing to him a paralytic, carried by four men. And when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. And when Jesus saw their face, he said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now, some of the scribes were sitting here questioning in their heart, "Why does this man speak like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sin but God alone?" And immediately, Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus questioned within themselves, said to them, "Why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier, To say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven? Or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. He said to the paralytic, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed and go home. And he rose and immediately picked up his bed and went out before them all. So that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. And so our story starts in Capernaum. And as you might know, Capernaum was Jesus' ministry base. When he started to preach the gospel, that was in that northern region in Galilee. And Jesus performed many miracles. Mark chapter 1 tells us about that. Miracles, healings, casting out demons, a lot of amazing things. And so the whole region was literally on spiritual fire. There were kind of an electricity in the air because Jesus was performing miracles. And that went so big that he went into the surrounding region to continue to preach and heal. And after a few weeks, finally, he comes back at Capernaum. And everybody wants to see him. All the people of the town gather to his house. And there are so many people that some of them cannot enter. They are there to put their head behind the door trying to hear what Jesus is saying. Among them, poor, rich, but most importantly, the religious leaders are here. And they are investigating. Is this Jesus really a prophet? Is he a liar, a deceiver? They're here to know. And then four guys come, carrying a fifth one, a paralytic. And today we want to focus on those guys, and let me give you a bit of context about that paralytic guy. This guy was a poor guy. We know that because when you're paralytic, you cannot walk. And if you cannot walk, you cannot work. That's a big problem. And you know, in the Jewish society, the man is supposed to take care of the family. Not only his family, but his parents, and his parents-in-law too. So a man who cannot work, he's not sustaining his family. His family is sustaining him. And this guy was living in a constant state of shame because the only way to get money was to beg at the city door or at the marketplace. That was the life of that man. He was completely broken. But that man, when he was there begging for mercy, heard rumors about Jesus, about that guy who was able to do so much. And then he said, why not me? What if I come to him and something happened? So he gathered four friends and said, guys, please bring me to Jesus. And that's the first component of relentless faith. If you have your outline, a relentless faith takes action. And now we want to understand what are the motivation of those four men to bring their friends to Jesus. Well, the first one is Jesus Christ himself. Think about it. The man is crippled. Nobody can help him. Nobody can heal a leg that does not move. That's impossible. The man has literally no other hope than Jesus. But he heard this rumor about this Jesus was so amazing. And we know it, brother and sister. We know that God who opened the sea in two, who even crushed death himself. And that's the first reason why faith is taking action. Because we know who Jesus Christ is. And think about it. There is another thing about that. Is that nothing in this world could satisfy that man. Nothing man could give him would be able to satisfy him. And that's the same thing for us. Think about it. No political system, no ideology, no way of life, no religion is able to satisfy this inner desire that we have. This craving desire of eternity that we all bear. There's still something missing. No treasure, no love, no dream is big enough to accomplish that. Only Jesus can. And you know, a buddy of mine, the French philosopher Blaise Pascal, said something about that. He said, man is seeking in things that are not there the help he cannot find in those who are here. Why? Because there is an infinite abyss in his soul that can be filled only with an infinite object. Namely, God himself. And so that's one thing, to recognize that Jesus is the only one. But there must be something else to get them in action, you know? How did they move beyond their self-centeredness? Well, I think the answer for that is love. Love is the second reason why we take action. And what is interesting is that love is something which is really not easy for us. You know, our ability to love this broken world is quite similar to our ability to face the sun. We cannot do it. If we try to face the sun and stare at it, our eyes will literally burn. So God made us really well, and therefore we have this reflex, and we turn our head and our eyes aside to not see the sun. The only way to see it is during an eclipse, and you know, to wear those funny glasses that are specially made to face the sun. That's the only way. Well, it's the same thing for us. We cannot face the brokenness of this world on our own. Our hearts are bad. Only through the love that Jesus can give us, we can bring people to him. And you know, when we put those glasses of love on our nose, everything changed. That's what Jesus did. And you know, when we see brokenness, we do not see the same way. For example, when we see a Muslim, we do not see someone who might be dangerous, that we're afraid of. We see someone who is pursuing a way that will not lead him to eternity, and that is losing his path there. When we talk with our atheist friend, we sometimes feel, you know, attacked. But when we wear the glass of love, what we see is that people who are so lost that they do not know that God loves them. And that's terrible. And when we wear those glasses, our hearts and our eyes must be wet. And we cry out to God, because that's the real misery of this world. And you know, as I was thinking through that, you know, we often say in the Western world that the worst thing that's happening to us is the growing of skepticism regarding Christian faith. That people do not go to church anymore. That people do not have the Christian value. Well, when I look at that text, I think that the thing we miss the most is love. We're no more known as a people who love. And you know, this world is very well aware of everything we stand against. But does it still know what we stand for? Think about it. When you listen to people, when you listen to the media, what adjective do they use to qualify Christianity? I look at it and I heard a lot of words starting with anti-something. A lot of words ending with phobic. And even if we have to hold fast to our truth, our word is perceiving us as haters. And that makes my heart sad. Because we're supposed to be the people who love. Remember John 13, verse 35. Jesus said, "By this all people will know that you're my disciples, if you have love for one another." Love must be your characteristic. And because those friends loved this paralytic man, and because they trust Jesus, they were able to take action. But as you know, and that's our second point, they have to face many obstacles. But they triumph for them. The relentless faith overcomes all obstacles. And we're going to see that they always have the same method to overcome them. It's self-sacrifice. Let's think about it. So first, they had to, after they agreed to carry their friend, well, they had to walk the long way to Jesus' home. So they sacrificed time to get there. I'm sure these guys did have a job. They had things to do. They had a family to take care of. They had a meeting to attend. But they laid their time aside to carry their friend to Jesus. The second sacrifice that's come with that is a financial one. Because as I told you, when they were carrying their friend, well, they were not working. And moreover, they dig into a roof. They will have to repay for that. They will have to rebuild it in some ways. So there is a cost. But they were ready to sacrifice everything to get to Jesus. And the third sacrifice that we might have a little bit a hard time to understand, that they sacrifice their honor. And I have to give you a little bit of context to understand that. In the Jewish culture, when you're healed with a strong disease like this one, or when you're a paralytic, that means that you have been cursed by God for your sin or your parents' sins. So when everybody was seeing this man on the street, they were saying, "This is a sinner. That's a man cursed by God." But did these friends care about that? No. They take their corner of the bed and they walk through Jesus, facing the shame of everybody else. All of this teaches us that relentless faith overcomes the circumstances of life through self-sacrifice. As Christians, that's something we should understand better than anybody else, because Jesus, the one we consider as our God, did the same, if you think about it. Not only by dying on the cross as an innocent man, but think that he left the glory of the Father, this eternal joy and peace, to come into that broken heart. In this broken world where there are so much limitation, Jesus gets thirsty, he gets tired, he gets hungry. He sacrificed all of himself for us. And you know, because in the Bible, the word to love, this verb is never a verb of declaration. It's not, oh, I love George, he's so great. It's not a simple acknowledgement. Love in the Bible is always a verb of action. And the way we demonstrate love is by self-sacrifice. And you know, this text does not explain us why this man is unable to walk. Maybe the Jewish were right, and maybe he offended God so much that God punished him. Maybe he was just born in that world like that because this world is totally broken by sin. Or maybe he did stupid choice and fell from a stair and broke his legs. That's also possible. But does love care about that? Not at all. Not at all. Self-sacrificial love does not care about the why. It cares about the who. This Jesus we have to get people through. And I don't know if you noticed, but the closer they get to Jesus, the harder it became. First of all, they had to carry their friend through the city to get to the house. But when they get to the house, it's getting crowded, so they cannot pass. So they were looking for an entrance, no one. So maybe, you know, in some Jewish house, there are a door on the roof. So maybe we go there. Well, how did they climb there? I have no idea, but they made it. And then, no entrance. We had to dig a roof. They get their hands dirty. They persevere until they saw the results. And persistency is key here. And in the whole Bible, it is because Job persevered in believing in God's goodness that God restored him. It's because Moses and Joshua believed that God's going to give them the promised land, that they conquer Canaan and they walk through the desert. Even if Israel deserved 100 times to die in that desert for its rebellion. Sacrificial love does not care about that. Sacrificial love brings people to Jesus. So, relentless faith is able to overcome all obstacles because, one, it is based on Jesus. It's rooted in love, demonstrated by self-sacrifice and fulfilled through perseverance. But now, let's look at the outcome of this guy's face. So they finally arrive to bring their friend down to Jesus, and then something quite unexpected happened. Jesus tells to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven. And I'm sure the four guys were looking into the hole and they were like, what? What did you just say, Jesus? That does not make sense. Wait a minute. We carried our body through the whole town. We sacrificed everything for you to heal him. Why are you talking about these sins? That does not make any sense for us. We were waiting for something spectacular. And that's our third point, my friend, is that relentless faith sees the power of God. But here, the power of God is first and foremost displayed in through salvation and not through the miracle. And that's maybe the most important thing of that text. That man, as we said earlier, what he needed most was its relationship with God restored. It needed to be saved. Because the Bible tells us that there will be such a time where there will be no illness, where there will be full joy, where there will be no tears at all. But this time is for later. It's for eternity. But to get to that, we have to pass through the gates of salvation. So, what would it be profitable for this man if Jesus had healed him right now? Not at all, because he would have lived better for a couple of years, but at the end, not at all. Man needs salvation more than healing. And so, these guys get confused, but I guess some of us get confused too when we read that story. Because the way the paralytic is forgiven is quite unusual for us. You know, he did not make any declaration of faith. He did not say, oh, I believe in Jesus. Oh, I repent from my sin. Anything like that, he did not say anything. Nor a prayer, nor a declaration. And the reason we might get a little bit uncomfortable with that is that we forgot the meaning of faith. Faith in Greek is pistis, and it comes from the verb to believe. But to believe in the Bible is never a simple intellectual acknowledgement of something. Like, I believe that it's sunny today. No, that's not believe according to the biblical logic. Believing means to place your entire trust in God without holding anything back. That's the definition of trust and of believing according to the Bible. And that's precisely what the paralytic demonstrated. He believed that there he had only one hope, Jesus Christ. So what did he do? He pursued Jesus Christ until he gets there. And that's what believing is. And you know, when I look at that, well, I feel a little bad. Because does my life reflect that? Do I have the same trust, the same confidence in God in everything I do? And, you know, I think that's Jesus seeing that, that's why he had a smile on his face and he said, child, with so much love, your sins are forgiven. But, you know, so these friends were confused. We get a little bit confused. But there is a third group of people who did not get confused. They get scandalized. That's the religious leader. That's the Pharisees. And, you know, Jesus committed, according to them, what is called a blasphemy. A blasphemy is when you say you can do something God can do, or that you are God. And basically, is that what Jesus is doing? Because we agree all on that, because only God can forgive sin, right? No man can do that. So Jesus is saying he's God. So I can guarantee you that these guys were ready to pick up stone and stone him at this very moment. Therefore, they think that Jesus is lying. But then Jesus comes in. That's the best part. Jesus is about to perform a miracle, not for the benefit of the paralytic. Look at the text. To prove them that he has the authority to forgive sin. To prove to the crowd, to the four friends, to the Pharisees that he can do what he claimed he did. And so Jesus is going to do something he's quite an expert in. He's going to answer the Pharisees' question with another question. I don't know if you noticed that in the gospel, but Jesus does that all the time. But for a very precise reason. It's because when people ask wrong questions, people ask wrong questions, and Jesus tried to correct them in that matter. So when Jesus answered by a question, he challenged them. That's what the rhetorical. He did not ask them really to answer. He was saying, okay, so we do agree that it's easy to say your sins are forgiven. And so we also agree that the real deal would be for me right now to heal that person, right? And if I do, well, that means I'm God. Because remember what we said earlier. In the Jewish culture, you believe that if you're healed, it's because you're sin. So you can't get healed if you're still a sinner. You must be forgiven before that. That's exactly what Jesus is doing here. And then, so Jesus commanded to the paralytic to walk. And immediately the miracle happened. Everybody was astonished and reacted the same way. They glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. And my friends, do we react the same way? You know, Pastor Ed told us, ask us to clap when we saw this baptism video. Are we still able to be amazed and wonder by what God is doing in our midst? When we see people's lives get changed, when we see baptism, when we see miracles. So now it's time to conclude. To whom do you identify this morning? Do you believe that you're a spiritual paralytic? That this life cannot bring you what you're craving for. Well, my friend, the good news is that Jesus can. And if you want to know more about that, please come at the end of the service. Meet me or Pastor Ed. We will be happy to talk with you. Are you like the scribes today? Do your thoughts and actions express doubts that Jesus is the only one who can save that world? Do you behave like you are the Savior? Are your heart and your eyes dried by self-centeredness or weighed by love for the lost? Or are we like those four friends, ready to sacrifice everything, time, treasure, and honor to bring people to Jesus, because that's what they need? Are we persevering, doing whatever it takes to bring them to Jesus? And Deerfield family, I want to challenge you this summer to pick up your corner of the bed. Each one of us has a corner to pick. You know, I want you to think right now about one or two people that are spiritual paralytics that you know. You know, this guy, when you see him, you say, oh, he seems so desperate. If only he knew how Jesus loved him. Or this girl who is feeling bad and you need, oh, if only she had a relationship with God, her life would be totally transformed. We all know people like that. We all know these people that are craving for Jesus. And this summer, we want to get them through the roof. And in the next week, we're going to help you with that. We're going to send you an email and help you to do that. But I want you now to take a second to think about that and to write down the name of this one or two people you're thinking about. Who are they? Who do you want to bring the gospel to this summer? Because they need it. It's a matter of life and death. And if you're ready to take a stand for that now, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we know that we're not the Savior. We cannot change people's life. We do not have this power. But Father, our hearts cry out because we know so many people who are in desperate situation. And either we do not love them, either they do not know you, Lord. And that's terrible. We're doing the wrong things, Lord. But this summer, we want this to change, Lord. We want to bring these people to your feet and let your power be displayed. We want to see your power of salvation through our friends, our loved ones, Lord. Because you're the God who can do everything. You're the God who is mighty to save, who overcome death. And we want to claim that now. You are the God who is mighty to save.